Hello. Am I audible? Hello. Can you hear me? People in the back? No. Yes, no, nothing. I cannot hear you. Oh. So, good morning and welcome everyone to PyCon. Before I start anything, I want to know a little bit more about you. Like, who all are here for the first time in PyCon? Can you please raise them? Whoa! That's like really amazing. Thank you for coming down. So, before anything else, I want to introduce myself. So, I am one of you. I'm just another participant, part of the community. And it's not only me, all the other speakers who will be here for today and tomorrow, they all of them are just like you. Every one of us started at zero at some time and everyone became part of this community. So it's really great that you people are here today, and I hope you enjoy these workshops and talks here right now, today and tomorrow. And by next year, we'll become part of the community fully. Be active volunteer and become an organizer for this conference, because I think we'll need a lot more help in the coming years. And little bit more things about myself, that I'm a CPython code developer. I'm also a director at Python Software Foundation. I don't know how many of you actually heard about PSF, the Python Software Foundation. Anyone? Okay, still a good number of hands. And we are actually going to have a PSF members meeting at 4 p.m. today at Audi 3. So if you are already a PSF member, you want to come down there to learn a lot more new things, or if you want to become a member and learn what all you can do for the Python as a community, you should come down and just have a chat. It's at the open spaces, Audi 3, 4 p.m. And I also contribute to a project called Fedora Project, which is the Linux distribution, as a brand ambassador. So there I go to different colleges, conferences, and talk about the project and things you can do and become a contributor. And a husband, important part. So actually, before going more into my talk, I want to say this thing, that my talk is very much personal. So this is not a technical talk. Throughout this talk, I'm going to talk about different projects, different people whom I met throughout my journey till now. And it's not something which already ended or I reached a place. It's still going on and it will go along throughout my life. So I'll share some stories with you. I share moments, projects, good, bad, both sides. So please bear with me all those stories, and I'd love to take questions in between also. Like, there will be a Q&A session at the end, but if you have any questions, you want to interrupt me and ask the question, feel free to. But longer questions, I would love to have them at the very end. So one word, upstream. Again, I want to know how many of you actually understand what upstream is. So throughout my talk, I'm going to use this word a lot of times. So I want to say a little bit for it. So when we say upstream in a free software or open source world, for some programs or one particular program, we mean the project where the people, project is not only the software, it's the people and everyone together who develops that particular program. That's the upstream. And when we say contribution to the upstream, that means when you are sending your changes or you are improving that upstream somehow. And this word came up from water, the rivers. So downstreams always get the improvement, the good things which happens in the upstream, correct? And upstream goes bad, the downstream will also go bad. So all ideas are coming from there. So why I started? So even though it's in the slide it's written 2004, but I want to go back a little bit more. I'm coming from a very small village in West Bengal named Ukhra, and I studied up to class 12 in Bengali medium there. And during 2001, I gave my joint entrance exam and came into an engineering college. And I used to stay in a college called Ari College, Durgapur. I never studied there, but I was there because of my exam. And I was staying in a relative's room. And I used to see computers there first time properly. I never had my own computer. And one day I saw, during my exam that particular day, I saw 12 people cramped up into a very small room, looking like this into the computer screen. So I thought that's something strange. Like, they're not playing a movie, I can understand. And everyone is watching, something is going on. So I asked the guy, like, hey, by the way, can you tell me what's going on? He said, don't make any noise. I said, why? He said, you know, we are installing something called Linux. And if the mouse works now, it will work. If the mouse does not work, it will never work again. So please stop. So that was my introduction to Linux. I'm like, oh wow, that means it's something which none of us know, only one person knows in the whole crowd. He is doing it. And rest of the people is like, oh, something is going on. So that's something I want to learn when I have my computer. I never had my computer. So I joined my college, it's a private engineering college, Dr. Bisra Engineering College in Durgapur. And I got my first computer. I installed Linux. I knew how to click random places, no clue more than that. And just learning few commands from the thing. So that's around 2004 in Durgapur, things started changing for me. I got access to internet. We never had internet connection in our college. Actually, we had a 56 kbps connection for all 900 students. So, but 2004, I actually managed to get my own connection, the same kind of using some Reliance connection. And I got access to internet and I can search or write emails easily. So things started there, and I came to know about these things or these places or group of people called Linux User Group. While searching about them, I again found a term I like, Indian Linux User Group. So you know, there are many people here from the other Linux User Group, correct? I like Bombay, I like Calcutta, I like Delhi, I like Chennai, very much active. So I found, oh, there is something in Calcutta also. And I found out about them more in a couple of magazines. I saw their names there, and then in that moment I actually tried to make contact. So I contacted this person here, who is here today also, Shankar Sen Mukhopadhyay. I saw his name and his one article from him in one magazine, and I wrote an email to him saying, I want to do this work, but I have no clue. Can you please help? And for a surprise, he actually replied to my email. And not only the reply, later on I received a CD with a Linux distribution inside, and which works, and it's completely in Bengali. I had no clue that I can use my computer in my mother tongue before that. And that's like, oh wow, it's a complete whole new world for me. A live CD, that is also new for me. I never saw a live CD before. I never saw my computer working with my mother tongue. And then he said a word which was again new word to me. You should contribute. And the word upstream also. So those are the new points which I learned first time then and there. And I started my Linux or free software contribution as a translator. So I hope you can understand or guess what a translator does, correct? What they do? Anyone? Loud. They translate? Correct. We have so many languages, correct? 23 Indian languages. So most of those languages that you can actually use your computer in your mother tongue, language it is right now, I hope, in a Linux. It's because there are people who are actually contributing and translating those English terms into something which you can understand and a proper word. So I started my life as a free software contributor, as a translator, and I was really, really happy to see my name in a website, that is the KDE India community. And their site, I saw my name. I'm like, oh wow, I am famous. That was first time I can see my name somewhere in the internet. I'm like, that's mind blowing, that's fun. There's more than enough I can ever ask for. That was my first reaction. And it was not that difficult. So from there, with the love, I decided that we should do something similar in Durgapur. So I started a group called DGPLUG, that's our website, you can check it later on, dgplug.org. Around 2004 we started things. So it's the Durgapur Linux User Group, that's why DGPLUG. And our motto, which I started with, learn yourself and teach others, because we never had any people in the local community who can teach others. I can tell you very frankly that I was the Linux expert in my college because of two things. Number one, I knew how to mount my Windows partition. It was really, really difficult. I mean, you don't know how difficult it was. So, mount command, correct? And somehow, while talking with ILAC Kolkata, I found out there is one thing called RPM, and there is this file XMMS-MP3, which if you install, you can play your songs on your Linux computer, which is again another big magic. No one ever knew about these things. So those two commands actually, and because I had the copy of XMMS-MP3, I was the Linux expert and I was the king. In a local area, everyone is coming, oh, I need help. What? New machine, install Linux, I want to play my songs. So that's where ggplg.org started, and our idea was that we will try to learn ourselves. Like the first thing what we did was, you learn these few commands, I will learn these commands, and then every week we'll meet in one place, in the college or wherever, and we'll share our knowledge. Like, you know, we can do this thing with this command, or you can click here, something magical will happen. So just to give you an idea how that thing used to go on. So obviously with Linux, I used to install everything, correct? I know many of, how many students are here, by the way? Okay, pretty good number. So it's for you. So when I installed Linux, we used to install everything, and I used to get this cute designer, QT, what do you call this cute designer? So I knew that it looked like something like VV, because that's what I knew that time. So I can open a dialog, oh, I can add buttons and everything. And then if I double click on anything, it used to open up a C++ editor. I'm like, what's going on? Why C++? I had no clue. I never knew that I can search and read about it. I can learn from it. But that's how everything started. Then things changed for me, my personal life. I finished up my college. Good days are over. Now I have to work. Got a job here in Bangalore, DSL, Deutsche Software Limited. It was the back end of Deutsche Bank, also, if you're wondering. So I came to Bangalore and somehow I saw an announcement that there is an event going to happen, FOSDOTING. That one conference actually changed my life in many different ways. I don't know how many of you actually came to FOSDOTING before. Many of those conferences happened here in this particular venue. This is the same venue where we had lot of times the same conference. I met suddenly all my people. So I talked about Shankar Sen, correct? But I never met him until end of 2006. That's also after FOSDOTING. I talked with many other ILAC Kolkata members whom I met first time, like Indranil Dasgupta here during FOSDOTING. I met all the other big rock stars about Linux from Linux world here in FOSDOTING. I never knew about them. I never knew what they are talking about. There are like lots of talks and, okay, no, I never understood what they are talking, but it's nice, I'll smile if they ask anything. That worked for me. But in that conference, suddenly I started getting a little bit of like courage to go and talk with people, to introduce myself. You know, I'm from here, I'm trying to do these things. And obviously I was writing code, but not enough. So this thing happened there. I heard about a language called programming language called Python before, but I never had enough clue about it. But there is something called Python BOF, and from a person, Satar Singh Kang. So in that BOF, they actually showed us how the language, I mean, what kind of language it is, how it works and the things. And he was giving a demo, like, you know, you can write code for your Series 60 Nokia phones. Who all remember those Series 60 phones? Okay, at least few old guys till now, guys and girls. So those Series 60 phones you can program using Python. I was like too much excited. Okay, I really don't want to like C++. I knew I had to write C++. That's what my idea was. But I can learn Python. So I had a chat after that BOF was done. Like, you know, I really want to write code for my phone. It would be lovely to do so. And can I use Python? And he's like, yeah, Kushal, you go back home, do it for phone. But I actually had a Symbian Nokia 7710 phone, which was Series 90, and unfortunately Python never works for Series 90. I mailed to Nokia and they replied me back after 6 months. The developer said, sorry, it took 6 months for the mail to reach to me, but the person who was in charge, and said, we are really sorry that Python will not work for your phone. But I was somehow hooked into that language. I was learning, I was doing small code, the examples, you know, hello world kind of, and learning about modules, how things actually work out. Oh, wow. So during that time, I wrote my first actual real or useful code, and that's some magic with the lights anyway. So for my job, I was in the R&D department of my company, and we had to help each and other teams, whoever need whatever kind of help, technical help. So one day, actually my manager came to me and he gave me a zip file, which is, I mean, basically a Perl library and a Perl command to parse something like Form 10K, which is some Form US. It's about your, I think, earnings, and you have to declare it to the government. So, and that form, and they said, like, we want to add some features to that program, and we want some different output. So I knew about Perl. I never saw the code before. I opened it, some alien language for me. Still an alien language for a lot of people. So I opened that and I'm like, okay, I have no clue what this is about. So I should find out someone in the company. I started asking around, who can help me out? So they said, there is a Perl team downstairs. I was in the second floor, go to the first floor, to the team, they will help you out. So I went to the team, I gave them the code, I told, explained them what I want. Then they said, okay, you know, we do not have time, come back next week. We'll figure it out, everything, we'll explain to you. I waited, I came back next week. You know, still we do not have time, please come back next week. I did that for 3 weeks. And then someone actually told me the truth, that, sorry Kushal, we can't understand what this code is doing. I'm like, okay, that's now a challenge, because my deadline is approaching and I have to do something. It is basically parsing one file and format and generating the output in a different file, if you are trying to understand what it was. And I told my manager, like, you know, I'm learning this new language called Python, and maybe I think I can use this language to do this much easier way. So the total code was around 100 lines. It worked perfectly, and I was so happy that something I actually wrote is useful. And that is my first actual code, useful code in Python. The same thing I did with another project. If any one of you know about a library management project called Koha, which is one of the topmost free software project in that area. So I wrote some code again to do those again file format changes from some proprietary format to Koha so that they can import the data. That was my first code, useful. Then during that time, another change came in my life. I always knew before that writing code, that's what matters. I never used to read code that much. Again, this tip again came from Shankar Sen that time, that I should try to read more and more source code. And the example he gave me was Anaconda. Who all knows what is Anaconda here? It's the installer which we use to install the Red Hat Linux operating system, correct? Right now the RHEL, the Enterprise Linux, the Fedora, CentOS, all of them, the installer. It's written in Python. So I remember I opened up the code, and on the main file and the top somewhere it was written, this is really bad example to learn Python. The code was useful. I was totally clueless. Like, what is going on? Why someone is asking me to read this code? I can't understand anything there. And then suddenly, I mean, more people came and they told me the same thing. Read more source code. Read more source code. I'm like, okay, maybe if someone, everyone is telling me that same thing, there must be some reason. Let me just start reading it. Slowly with time, I started understanding the features of the language by reading it. I slowly started understanding why I can, how I can do better than what I was doing it. So this is very important to try to remember that read more source code than you write. If you remember last year, Jay says something similar in this line, correct? That writing code is a liability. Whoever was there last year for the keynote about writing code. So, but as a student, if you are a student, you are learning the language, you should try to write more code also, because that's the time where you are learning, correct? One more person, Shyamendu Dasgupta. In my mind, he is the best programmer from India. That's what I think. I don't know how many of you actually heard about him, but he is from Calcutta. Right now, he's doing his PhD in Media Labs in MIT. He is one of the code developers for the Scratch project. So he was one of the primary developers for the Ankur Bangla group, where I started learning the all contribution free software upstream work. So Ankur Bangla, I actually missed that point. Ankur Bangla group is the group which does for the Bengali language. We have two groups, Ankur Bangla Bangladesh, BD and IN, for the Indian Bengali language. So he was part of that group who actually developed that first Linux, Ankur Bangla Linux. And he is a very close friend, and he was there at that time in Calcutta. So I always used to think that I'll go to his house and learn a lot from him. I used to stay in Bangalore, take a flight to Calcutta, I'm going back to my village. So I'll stay that night in his house. I'll learn a lot. 10 p.m. I'm really pumped up. Like, hey, I'm going to sit beside you and I'll see what you are doing. Nothing else. I'll just sit beside you and watch. 5 minutes, I'm like, okay, I have to stay awake now. And 10 minutes, 15 minutes, I'm sleeping there on his desk. So it happened not once, not twice, many times that I went to his house, but slept all across the whole night. That I am here, but I couldn't learn anything from him. But somehow his thoughts, his ideas actually came to me, and I understood why he was doing all those work. The one of the biggest thing I learned from him, that anything is possible, even if you are staying at your house. He was the first person who showed me this thing. He was in his house and developing all the into the core things which I knew at that moment. He later on, during that time, he moved into another project called OLPC. He was a developer. Again, OLPC is one laptop per child. I'll come about it in few minutes and say a few more stories there. And I was doing this thing continuously from 2005 to 2000, like this is, I'm talking about 2007 when I started, like I'm writing a little bit more Python code. I was kind of happy. And another project which I did around this time was about photography. I love photography. I love taking photos. And I learned about a website called Flickr where I can upload photographs. And I think the highest photographs you can upload was 20 MB. That was the fee limit. That's what I remember. But Yang is in Bangalore, correct? Yes? So one of the employees who actually worked with that team closely, he told me, by the way, Kushal, if you want to upload more photos, there is a way. You can email those photos to your email ID in the Flickr, and that will take you more than 20 MB photographs in a day. And that's like, wow, amazing. But then I have to manually keep adding each picture in one email and sending it. So I wrote my first, a little bit bigger application called K photo by mail. It was for KDE, so K photo by email. That is the topic. So it's just a simple GUI. Select few photographs, it will show you a preview, and click using SMTP lib, start sending the emails. So that's my, you can say that was another big project in my life. Because there are a few people who actually used it. Oh, the picture is not that visible. But during this time, I met another person whom you saw a few minutes back on stage, Anand Pillai, someone who can look up to. He started this group here in Bangalore called Bangpipers, Bangalore Python Users Group, where I came and suddenly saw there are so many people who are like-minded, who love this language, who wants to talk about many new things, what is going on in this language. So that was something new for me. Like, I never knew people with languages had this kind of group. I only knew about Lux before. And like, okay, these are very nice people, and he taught many things. I mean, I read his source code, the projects he was working on, so that I can learn from him. And at the same time, wow, do you mind to go to the next slide? I met a retired lawyer. He was a far better programmer than most of us here right now standing. He was more enthusiastic about the work, and he was a true-hearted person. Whatever he believed, he just went for it. On mailing list, on blog, when you meet him in person. Some of you actually can guess his name. log on, Kenneth Gonzalez, correct? So he was a close friend. He was someone from whom I can learn and see. Like, I can still say, even today, I go to so many colleges, meet so many students. But at this age, he's not from computer science, correct? He's a lawyer. But he was more enthusiastic about writing program and having fun than most of the students I meet today. So that thing is important in life, having fun. Please do not forget that part while you are working on things. We all miss him. Then one more person. I'm not sure if JC is here till now. Not here yet. So I hope people from Bangalore actually can recognize this name. Actually, people, anyone from India, JS Kiran, correct? He is again a friend, a mentor, my manager also in my one of my job. So I started learning a lot from him at the same way. So I want to share one particular story between all those stories. One of my office work was actually, we were doing a replacement for a Windows login screen, Windows, that's correct, which the Windows was running on a Linux VM. The login screen will authenticate using fingerprints, which was go to that Linux VM into a SMTP service and authenticate through the SMTP service, the fingerprint. So that service was written using Python. It's kind of complicated, I know, and stupid. It sounds stupid, but it worked very well. It's around 2007, the story. So I was writing, I was quite confident I can write good Python code. Oh, I know this module, I know this module. It works. I know the SMTP loop, there is a module I can write a, what do you call, the authenticator or the service. So I spent 2 days. I wrote code which worked, tested everything perfect. Tested means I just ran it and it works. That was my testing. So I came down, I'm like, oh, and he was sitting inside a room and like was discussing something. And Parson, he was my colleague at that time. And I just wrote this code to him, just like, yes, this is what I wrote. He looked at it, he's like, oh, Kusal, nice. But you know what, you should sit beside me. And he asked me to sit beside him, and while sitting there for the next 2 hours, he actually started rewriting the code from the scratch. And it's like a drawing, it's like a painting. It's a different thing completely for me. I never saw people actually writing code in front of me, the pair programming thing before. He wrote test cases, he wrote the documentation, how the things is working and everything. I was like, that's strange. The same code, but it looks so beautiful for me. So that is one of the incidents. So, but at the same time, because our team, we were doing only Python code, I should say only, yeah. So there's a lot of things to learn from him. And how many of you have heard about the Hasgeek, JS company? Correct. This will be a pretty good number. And I actually told him that I'm going to talk about this point, that in general in life, when we were kids, we always wanted to become good cricketers, correct? In India, people who like cricket, anyone? Like, we all wanted to become either Sachin, Dravid or Ganguly, no one else, in general. If you are a movie star, we want to follow like Amitabh Bachchan, Shahrukh Khan, Salman Khan, become that successful, that someone like that. And I know that many people, many students in Bangalore, they all want to become like Jace. They want to be successful in the same way. They want to be known. But for mostly what they miss is another small word called hard work. If you see all those people who are successful in life, ask anyone, any of the authors, people who are doing great. Ask them that it actually took time. It's actually a lot of hard work. I think you know Sachin's story, correct? How hardworking he was and he is till now. It same goes with programming. Things will not come to you in 1 day, 1 month, 1 year. You have to keep doing it. So there are those books, correct? Learn programming in 24 hours. You can go and search about, I forgot the exact title, it's about how to become a better programmer in 10 years. Search about it, read about it. It takes time. Ask anyone, I mean, Prabhu, you can explain it better than me in this way. Yeah. So that's my example. But it takes time to become, to reach certain level. That is the thing I want to say. And if you want to, if you think that you can just act cool, behave cool, I'm properly hipster, I'm wearing this particular clothes, or I'm talking about only these upstream projects, I'm a cool guy. That might work some places, But when you come and talk with the other people who are good at that thing, it will not work. Not at all will work. The only way you can become better at anything, even in lying, in court, the Indian politicians, many cases, I mean, they also work hard, correct? So whatever you do, if you want to go on the top, you have to work really, really hard for it. Everyone work hard. Sidelining things from Bangalore. These all things were happening in Bangalore. I'm not. Can we reduce these lights, please, on the stage? So, I don't know how much you can see in that image. So this another project we picked up in Durgapur. It's called Bijra project. So Bijra is actually a school. It's a remote village within Durgapur, the town, where the students, they never had proper clothes to wear when going to the school. Not proper textbooks and anything. But with help from West Bengal University of Technology, the VC, Professor Ashok Thakur, and from IELTS Calcutta, Indranil Dasgupta, and DigiBiology volunteers like Shomokanti Chakraborty, what we managed was 5 computers, dumb terminals and 1 server, desktop, and install a complete Bengali server app there. And the students were mostly learning by themselves. And it was not about teaching computer, it was using computer to teach the normal study things. They were learning about geography, they were learning about history, Bengali literature. There are many texts, correct? Project Gutenberg for other English literature. So this is another image. And the best part about this project, there were no teachers. They were learning everything of their own. And it was following the same motto which we had and we still have, that learn yourself, teach others. Bengali, shekho ebong shekhao. Nije shekho, logo ko shekhao, that way. So that was kind of different. It's not about programming, it's not about doing things, but it was giving back to the community, getting more people into the community. And in 2007, I was introduced to another project, OpenPCD. It's the first open hardware for RFID, 13.56 MHz. It was an open hardware, open software project. So it was, the project is obviously, you can do many things in this using C. There is a C library, libRFID, to work on it. So I decided that I don't want to write C, so I'll write the Python bindings. So I figured out that somebody told me that you can write, you know, in Python also. Like you have to just write some wrappers, some binding, and like, okay, these are strange words, but I'll search about it in google.com. So I did that. I started reading about it, I wrote the first versions, and then I went to actually a conference in Berlin, LinuxTag, and I was working in the, I gave a talk about this and I was showing my code and demo everything. The code was working, but the primary developer for this was like Milas Mariak. He came and he told me like, you know what, we need to install this also, so you have to write a makefile. How many of you actually know about makefile? Oh wow. I also thought that I knew makefile. I had that glory, correct? I know everything. Young kid thinking that everything is easy and useful. So one night, like my friend used to work almost 16 to 20 hours a day. So around in the evening, I started writing the makefile. Not compelling, okay, what is the next library I can add into this? Hyphen L, keep adding the libraries till it works. It worked at around 6 a.m. I'm so happy. I have a working makefile. It just works. Perfect. I mean, his wife was also awake with me. She is also an hacker who made the hardware design actually. So she was looking at my progress and she's like, oh, Kushal, congratulations. It worked. I'm like, now he has to wake up and I'm going to show him this. My laptop. Hey, Milos, this is working. He looked at that code, the makefile, looked at me, smiled. And the reaction was, you know, Kushal, even my grandmom can write better makefile than you. Go jump from the window. And if you are wondering, that was 5th floor. So I made a decision for myself that I'm going to come back to India and learn about this. It's okay. It's perfectly okay. I understood. They also explained that it's okay that I do not understand what makefile is or how these things work. But it's my duty in one way to actually learn about it in future. so that next time when I'll come to a project where I have to use the same technology or the OEM thing or Macfile auto tools, whichever we want to call it, I can use it actually. So I learned, and in many other projects I used auto tools, I used the same technology and it works now. And I know how to copy paste. I mean, I still can't write from scratch. I know how to copy paste it well. Then something we started, it's called DigiBiology Summer Training. That's also a pretty unique thing. It's an online summer training, free for everyone who has a Linux computer and internet to join. It runs for 3 months during summer. And we teach starting from communication, editors, and then how to use Python to solve your daily problems. We do not teach Python as a programming language only, but we try to teach them how to use this language and solve the problems you have. I am not going to explain the kind of problems students generally get into, scary things, but most of them actually manage problems using Python, funny ways. I love to talk about those stories outside in the hall when no one is recording. And at the same time, I also worked into a project called LiveUSB Creator. As I am saying, like, all these things are actually my stepping stones. I am learning a little bit more through in my journey. I am learning a little bit more. So LiveUSB Creator is application for Windows. It was, I think, announced in Indian daytime, early morning, from a guy called Luke Macken from Fedora project, that you can install a live CD into a USB. Nice thing, but it was a command line. So I knew PyQt that time, the Python version or the Python bindings for Qt. So I thought I'll try to write a UI, very simple UI. What? By around 4 p.m. I actually, Indian time, I sent him the code. You know, I did this, have a look. So after a few days, he actually blogged about it, that he was working on a PyGTK version of the tool. And he got my code from, he never knew me that well, but suddenly one guy sending him code which just works. And he liked my code and the PyQt better. And that whole thing there from that time became, like, that was his first and only, I think, PyQt code, which still works. It works on Windows, Linux, Mac, everywhere. And I worked on that logo also. That is also a contribution. It's always not about programming. I cannot draw a straight line well, but somehow managed with the tools to make this one. So that was a point when I learned, okay, like, I can talk directly to these people. They are not aliens. They will not beat me up if I send them wrong code. I saw it before OpenPCD, and then that was a big help. And again, I am very much excited because all those project pages, they have my name now. And it still excites me. Even today, I see, oh, my name is somewhere. It's nice to have it. Then I changed my job. I joined this company, Red Hat. It was a huge thing in my life. It was kind of dream. Not to become part of the company, but more about the people, the culture. I was in the Pune office, so I had there many upstream contributors. I was lucky again to have Sankarsan first time officially in my career. He was my manager. I had people like Rahul Sundaram, Ramkrishna Reddy, but many one of you already know about him, Aman Alam, Parag, who all are upstream developers in many projects. So whenever we used to meet for a cup of coffee or talking, making joke about random things, but somehow technology used to come into those talks. So those things affected me a lot to learn to, every day I can hear new technical words, which I have no clue. And the lights are doing many magics. See? And I also moved into OLPC. That's the laptop I was talking about, one laptop per child. Saminto was working on it and he asked me to work for its audio video application. It's called Jukebox. I worked on it. It was then available to everyone who has an OLPC. And suddenly in few days, I learned that writing code for 10 people is very easy. Writing code for 50,000 kids is insane. And those kids, not only they use the application in the way which I never thought they will use, breaking all use cases, they also came to know how to use IRC and talk to the guy who actually wrote it. So I can keep seeing these random people, Nicks, coming up on the channel and has sugar for the OLPC and asking me, you know, how I want to do this, how to do this, this video is not working. It was It is scary and it is fun. It is a lot of fun. And the biggest thing I learned was be patient with people and users say everything. If they say that your code is okay, you are okay. You don't have to hear about from anyone else in that way. And from 2006, I was using Fedora all across. That's my operating system. I am running it right now in my laptop. But I was becoming more involved into the project. So I worked with the Fedora infrastructure team. So there are people like Toshio, Pingu, Nirik. These are the nicknames or the names. So one of the major things which I learned while working on infrastructure is that everything new and shiny may not be that great for you. So there are many web devils, correct, here. Many people who write web code. Please raise the hand if you can see. Okay, still a lot. And as a student, you always attracted to the new shiny module, correct? Somebody wrote this, I have to use it right now. We also get that feeling. It works many times. But as a part of the Fedora infrastructure or something, I have to remember that if I use a new Python module, I'll be the guy who will be packaging it. That's my pain. I have to go through the pain of package review. That means somebody will go through each thing I did and make sure this is perfect for the operating system to use. And then I have to support it into the APL, that enterprise repository, for next 5 to 6 years. So that's something which taught me stay within the standard library, Python standard library, as much as possible. I do not want to reinvent the wheel, but I try to prefer use minimum things. Everything shiny and new is not great all the time. And you must work in an enterprise company. Any enterprise company in India, you'll learn a lot about it. How those COBOL and C++ applications are still working and working great. So during that time, I also tried my first upstream project. I wanted to work on PyPy. You heard about PyPy? It's a Python compiler written in Python, correct? Or Python? So I thought I'll compile it. I had a laptop, a powerful one, 4GB RAM. So not possible. I tried, failed. Went to HashPyPy on IRC. They told me, you know, Kushal, it's not going to be that easy for you to compile it there. But why don't you try with something else, like CPython? I'm like, what is CPython? Like, oh no, that's the language you use, Python, the interpreter. Okay, I can start looking into that. That's how I came into CPython, the programming, the language upstream thing. And my first patch was actually went through the Fedora package. So you all know the help command, correct? In the interpreter, help, opening, closing parenthesis, and then you can type modules to see all the modules. But in Fedora, we always used to see that modules command used to crash. The whole Python interpreter used to go out. Never knew why. Then I started looking into the code. I found there were many modules or libraries in that way who had a sys.exit0 inside their code. That means if you actually try to use it in a wrong way, it will just terminate the whole process. So I tried to write some patch and some stuff for few of those, like not the sys.exit0, we actually fixed it in the upstream. LiveUSB creator was one of that, which did that, our own project, but we fixed it. And that's where I figured out, okay, people can actually accept my patches. Then one more person, Siddhesh Purvekar. How many of you have heard about libc? Libc. What is it? The C programming library, correct? The actual C, what do we say, sometimes in student, as a student, C software. The programming language. So glibc is the upstream, the C implementation. So he's an Indian who lives in India and he's an upstream libc developer. That means all of you, almost all of you, are actually using his code right now. If you go to the libc devil and see how many people are committing code, there are actually around 5 people who are doing the upstream devil, regularly committing code. Only 5 in the whole world. He is one of them. He is my friend. Someone who keep pushing me so that I keep doing more work for the CPython, the language itself. It's like, Kushal, stop all other nonsense you are doing, random code I write for myself, and try to work upstream, contribution. Make sure that you do more contribution in the upstream directly. It's okay, it's easy, it's not that difficult. So keep pushing me, even he works for Red Hat, and lucky for me that we used to interact a lot in that way. Then this fancy name, now you all know about it, correct? PyCon India. The first year I actually missed it because it was during Durga Puja times, but from then every year I come here. I meet so many other people who are doing great stuff. They are the speakers, they are talking about things. Even the students who came and asked me questions, which I have no clue. So I have to go back and read about it. This conference is something, it's very personal again. It's all the people, all the friends here. Everyone is a friend. If I don't know you, I can meet you. I mean, I will meet you this time. Maybe next year when we meet, we will be already a friend by using technology, internet. Maybe I will not talk to you over internet, maybe I will meet you again next year, but we all are friends. Remember this, that this conference is run by volunteers. So if you see something is a problematic, if you see something is wrong, so please come and tell anyone and try to help to fix that thing. We all can improve ourselves when we try to help each other. Nick Corlin, again core C Python developer, who did the final push to me that, you know, Kushal, you have to work more and make sure your patches goes in. And Michael is here right now. He is going to do the keynote next day. But he also helped, David Murray, he also helped me a lot in the upstream, and my patches started going inside the code, and I got the review commit commit access and become a C Python code developer. So it never happened in one day, but there are many people who keep pushing me for this, and so that I'm doing over with. I'm actually showing a picture for the development sprints. So development sprints are something where people meet, sit together, meet and keep talking about or doing work, not only keep talking, actually doing work on different projects. So this is an example about C Python development, actually Python development sprint during PyCon in US. So the guy on the left, he was in our table and he was having a problem with Mercurial, HG command. And we never knew how to fix it. So we are just saying, I don't know how to Mercurial. Anyone knows Mercurial that well? And suddenly I saw a bunch of people standing behind us like this. Oh, what's the problem, by the way? We may want to help you. I'm like, okay, who all are you? So he was helping. He's the guy who wrote Mercurial. And that team was like the whole Mercurial development team. So they were apparently working just in the next table and they heard the word. So all across the 4 days of development sprint, whenever we said anything to Mercurial, they all are up and coming. Oh, you need any help? So that's the best thing about development sprints in any community, not only Python. You do for any other community. You will see the upstreams just beside you. The way you can get help from them, it's not possible anywhere else. I think I'm going over time, but if you can excuse me for a few minutes. So for anything on the upstream, what is the most important factor on the, it's a single word, simple word. Can anyone guess what's the word? Fun. Fun is also very important. Upstream people, we do it not only for a job or work because we have fun. We love it. But also trust. It's all about trust. The community actually trust each other very much. That's where when they decide to give you commit access, that's where you become a part of the organization. You part of that whole community. Say for this, the organizing committee of PyCon India. It's about the trust, and the trust will only come when you keep doing these things. And for students, again, like I'm targeting this thing particularly for you. Please try to remember that the journey is important, not the end station, the end points. And it will never end. It will be on throughout your life. Not as a programmer maybe, but as a different things. We will have to learn many things, correct? You will have a family, you will have your own kids. You have to learn, keep learning new things. So that's all about the journey. So I heard a new, nice line about yesterday from Naufal here. It's about like people, most of the times what they do is that they underestimate the long-term goals and they overestimate the short-term goals. That in next 7 days I will learn these things, I will solve all these problems. But I cannot do this even in next 1 year. Sorry, yeah, that's just too much. I can't do this. That's not the point. You should try to learn new things. You should try to do more stuff. and you will figure out slowly and eventually that you can achieve much more than what you see now. I saw it in my life. All the last few jobs I am working on or worked before all came through my upstream contribution, through those people. I have friends in different companies. It's the same people here. They all will be your friends. You can get a job also if you want a job. But you have to keep working. You have to keep doing new stuff. So please keep doing those things. That's like, I should say that's the last line from me in one way. And I want to have a little bit of question answer session. Like if you have any questions, I think there are mics. No question. 5 minutes if I can get. Just 5 minutes, not more than that. I thought I will have some more questions. If you have any kind of questions, please feel free to. Any questions, anyone? No questions? So generally when we go to colleges, what I say or we say, if there is no question, that means only two things. Number one, you understood everything. Not possible. No one understood anything. Always possible. So I'm going to think in that way now. So if no questions, I can just get down. Okay, there's one hand. Okay, someone understood something. I'm happy.
So you were talking about code sprints. Do you know of any code sprints that happen in India?
There are different communities who does those things. I mean, it's not happening directly even in PyCon, but there are open spaces. Every year, I know there are friends and there are people who are working on those upstream projects. We actually sit there with our laptop and show the students or anyone who wants to know about those projects and like these are the bugs you can solve. And then there are other projects like AD community and like many other communities which do separate particular code sprints. So those things happen in India. You don't have to go out for it. And many code sprints you can actually attend over internet. So you can do that. They will have a list, like for Python, we'll have a list of bugs which you can solve. We will try to help you over internet. Any more questions?
I think you are using the upstream words quite frequently. And I think a lot of them are in the initial stages of Python learning. They know different modules. They know importing the libraries. So could you suggest us what are the code, I think you were referring during the talk, that you refer different codes, the source codes. So could you just refer some of them so that we can refer them and...
Okay, so if you want to read, the question is about, please, can I quote some code or some source code which you can read and learn about, correct?
Yeah.
So the first thing I want to suggest is a nice language called Python. Go to standard library. It's in your computer, go to the standard library lib directory. There you will find most of the Python modules. It's written in Python and trust me, they have enough code comments and documentation inside, doc strings. Some of the Python, okay. But still, you can understand those code. It's not rocket science. So feel free to read, start from there. There are a couple of blog posts and things. I actually missed one point I want to say about that part. See, I was talking about the journey thing, correct? And I want to give one example. There are many GSOCers in India, correct? GSOC students, ex-GSOC students, or current students. Couple of them, correct? What happens in India is that people do the GSOC and they just vanish from that project. But you are supposed to, through GSOC, you are supposed to become part of the community. So there is a girl among us here today, Charu. She is from IIIT Ellava, correct? So she started contributing before GSOC into federal project. She is here, you can talk with her afterwards. She contributed during GSOC as a GSOC student and she is still now the contributor. She is becoming an upstream contributor. So if you want to learn more, someone who is already a student, you can come and talk with her. She is a direct example here who is actually doing contribution. So please continue doing contribution. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask any one of us during these 2 days. We'll have to help you out and later on also over emails and stuff. And this is my Twitter handle. So Kushal Das, not that difficult. Hopefully you will be able to remember. So if you have any questions or any good or bad things, throwing stones, please feel free to do it over Twitter, not in real life. And then thank you.
Thank you, Kushal, for those words. I would request everyone to please